the Pilot TV podcast this week, we are breaking storms with Alex Rider in Amazon's adaptation of the Anthony Horowitz book series, hitting the pitch with Will Arnett in our overdue but still championship qualifying review of The First Team, exploring the lighter side of infidelity in The Other One, and investigating a murder in the snow in season 4 of Cardinal, a Canadian detective drama which you'll find out all about this week as it makes its way to BBC Two for the very first time. Plus, Vicky McClure swings by the podcast to talk to her old chum Boyd about all things Alex Rider and a little Line of Duty as well. I'm James Dyer and welcome to the Pilot TV podcast, a show that has just drafted an executive order to have the comments section of Apple Podcasts shut down after Thexman from Sweden left us a one-star review this week and said, and I quote, "Turned off after 10 minutes when I realized all they do is coming up with horrible jokes that they then laugh at by themselves. Horrible people, horrible podcast," which I think we can all agree is just fake news. However, joining me this week on our horrible podcast are my two equally horrible co-hosts. First up, a man who engages in such sordid practices as stalking British celebrities who he then forces to befriend him while spending his downtime ensconced in a den of iniquity watching episodes of Breeders in the Dark. It's Bad Boyd Hilton. Hello, Boyd.
I don't recognise any of that description, but thank you.
Our third co-conspirator, a woman whose crimes against quality science fiction television are too numerous to recount here, whose refusal to accept Farscape into her heart will forever be a stain upon her family's honour. It's Terry Blackheart White. Hello, Terry.
Hi.
I'm literally, all the way through that, I was watching you take a variety of selfies from no less than seven separate angles. What are you doing?
Well, it's what bad people do, James. Narcissism.
Yes,
is
narcissism
that, yeah?
For your Instagram stories.
It's a well-known trait. I mean, to be fair to the gentleman from Sweden, I don't know if we're bad people, but we do tell bad jokes and then laugh at them. So I think we're bang to rights for at least half of his statement. Apologies for the bad jokes and laughing at them.
It's not just the bad jokes that apparently are the problem. So I went through our recent reviews and had a lot of five-star ratings, which we could. But among the five-star ratings, and in fact inside some of the five-star reviews, a lot of people did mention, and I quote, "unnecessary swearing."
Oh, no.
Apparently, this is a black mark against us, the unnecessary swearing. Now, I kind of get that swearing on a podcast is a little inconvenient when you want to listen in front of your kids, though, frankly, they probably know more swear words than you do. But I have, honestly, on a personal note, I've always found the kind of prohibition on profanity quite baffling. So why is the C-bomb so offensive when the word vagina is not, when they're both semantically identical? Like, logically, it makes no sense.
Well, that's like saying, no. What's the difference between saying fuck and screw? I mean, they're just words.
Yes.
Yeah, but that's the whole point about swear words. And they gain power, don't they, over time for various reasons. But I can imagine if the first podcast of ours you ever listened to was the one with Ricky Gervais where we talked about the word cunt relentlessly for about, then I can see how it might be a shock to some people.
Maybe. I mean, but there is a long history about kind of the semantics and social power of cunt and where that's come from. I did it at university as part of my English language course. But maybe we should try not to fucking swear so much.
I see what you did there.
Should we though?
It's quite funny. So like in English, swear words apparently tend to have a sort of a Germanic origin.
Yes.
So like I think shit and fuck both have Germanic origins. But the term profane originates from Latin profanus, lols, which literally means outside the temple. So essentially desecrating what is holy. Because the original swear words were, you know, things like damn. So it was taking the Lord's name in vain. And I think if memory serves from my theology degree, this all stems from something in Deuteronomy, which is about by his name alone you shall swear. So it was about swearing oaths on God's name. Therefore, when you took God's name in vain, you were swearing an oath outside its divine purview, and that was bad. So I think that's where swearing originates. But when it became like social profanity, it was all about voicing social taboos. So it wasn't so much about the words, it was about sort of the meaning. So like bastard was a really big thing to call people in Elizabethan eras because bloodlines were really important.
Yeah.
So that was a horrible thing to do. Apparently, the worst thing you could say to a Roman citizen in ancient Rome was that they practiced cunnilingus. Absolutely true. Because apparently
still true
it was,
for a lot of men, James.
Yeah, apparently it's the worst insult you could throw because it was about all passivity in front of women was seen to be shameful to Roman men. Yeah, it's about weakness.
Like there's a lot of stuff around men who give oral sex to women being weak.
And that's where
What was the word they used though? Because obviously there's cocksucker for the, in a similar. There was one word for
One word for that? Oh, God, fuck knows. I have no idea. There probably is a specific Roman insult about that, but I don't know how to sling that particular one.
We haven't done enough research on that.
But the old swear words that they used to have were things like "by God's bones" and "by God's wounds" was something that people used to use a lot. And words like, I don't know if "fuck" is one, but I know "cunt" was not a swear word. It didn't used to be a swear word. Like, it was just used in common parlance to refer to that part of the female anatomy.
Which part, James?
The vagina, Terry. This is why Grope Cunt Lane was the most common street in England, because it's where they used to find prostitutes, and they used to just call it Grope Cunt Lane. But there are street names, Shite Well Way, Fucking Grove. These are all places that were in England. And names as well.
I like the fact that our response to a complaint about us swearing is to have more swear words in this podcast than ever we've had before. I mean,
doesn't that just sum up this podcast in a nutshell? Yeah. We just double down on this shit. But it's true, like, even personal names in the Middle Ages, like Cuntless was actually a surname. Godwin Clawcunt is apparently an actual person. I mean, I don't even want to know how he got his name, but this is a thing. And so I guess just over time it stopped being a descriptive term and became an expletive. But there's a really interesting piece in Wired as well, where I may have gone down a rabbit hole on this, where they talk about how it's partly to do with semantics about what these things mean, about when words, they get power by challenging social taboos. So racial epithets become powerful in a negative sense because of the connotation. But sometimes it's about the aesthetics of the word. So cunt is a very caustic word with two hard consonants.
Phonetics.
And cock is as well.
Yeah.
And so, they derive power partly from the shape of the word, not just from the meaning.
Because the sound, the phonetics of it is really important.
To bring it back to television, did you know that the BBC has a list of all the swear words in order of ranked in order of offensiveness, and it used to be the case, I think they've phased this out now, that if you were making a TV show and you wanted to have swear words in it, you had to adhere to, so you could have like three cunts post Watershed within half an hour or something. So they have quite strict rules about it, but the top of the list wasn't cunt. So for the BBC, their most outrageous word that anyone could use was motherfucker.
Really?
And it was weird. And I always thought it was really weird. And I didn't believe it until they sent me. I got someone to fax me over the list because I wrote an article about it once. And it was true. Motherfucker was more offensive to them than cunt. I don't know if that's still the case.
That's often been the case in certain countries. Like Italy, that's a big thing, because obviously defaming someone's mother is seen as socially taboo. So it has more power there.
Yeah. Can I just say that actually why this is like the most perfect us way to deal with this complaint is massively over-intellectualizing it and like disappearing right up our own arses when discussing swearing. That's what makes it a pilot podcast reaction to a complaint about swearing.
I have a couple more facts for you though before we wrap this up. And that is, if you check the Chester County Court Rolls of 1310, there is a gentleman on the roll called Roger Fuck by the Navel. Absolutely true. And there are other people. So John Le Fucker in 1278, Henry Fuckbeggar in 1286, and Simon Fuckbutter, I mean, Jesus, in 1290. So clearly it was quite common back in the day. Here's another fact for you. Swearing in and of itself is not a criminal offence in the United Kingdom, although it is a criminal offence in Salford Keys under a public spaces protection order, which outlaws the use of foul and abusive language. So if you go to Salford Keys and call someone a cunt, you can theoretically get arrested for it. So that's an interesting fact for you. Another fact, perhaps my last, is that apparently our brains process swear words differently from other language. So actually it's most propositional speech words are formed in the left hemisphere of the brain, where swear words come mostly from the limbic system in the right hemisphere. So people whose left hemispheres have been damaged by strokes, Alzheimer's, whatnot, can sometimes still swear even though they can't talk otherwise. That's a fascinating fact.
Is it?
Right. Okay.
To bring it back to TV again, do you know what the first American use of the C word of cunt was on American television ever?
I know what it was in film. It was said by Jack Nicholson. But what's the TV one?
The TV one is The Larry Sanders Show. in 1992, which, funnily enough, I was going to mention in relation to something coming up any minute now on this podcast. Yeah, but Larry Sanders' show led the way with the use of the word cunt on American TV, and then Sex and the City joined in quite soon after.
But Americans have a weird relationship with that. I've mentioned on this podcast, I think, before, the show The Magicians, which is a show that I quite enjoyed, where they would bleep out fuck, but they left cunt completely unmolested. And I thought that was a really odd approach to censorship, but sure, you know, whatever floats your boat.
That is weird, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, I hope for those of you who object to the Pilot TV podcast swearing are feeling a little better about yourselves now, and and we've addressed that issue to your satisfaction. Shall we move on now to what we've been fucking watching? Terry.
Right, so I've got one thing that I tried to watch and had to turn off, which I wanted to talk to Boyd about, and the other thing, which is the Jeffrey Epstein docuseries on Netflix. Did this drop this week? I think, yeah. Boyd, I'm looking at
Wednesday,
you over the
yeah.
internet. Wednesday. And it's a four-part, hour-long, each episode documentary, essentially. And what they did, in effect, what's most interesting, I suppose, is they started making this and researching it even before Epstein had been arrested. So they kind of knew all the stories out there. But I think they started with this assumption that he was too well protected and he would never, ever be brought to justice. Obviously, the events then kind of took a very dramatic turn when not only was he arrested, but then he died in prison. And what's really interesting about it is they've really diligently gone and tracked down tons of survivors, some of whom have spoken before, some of whom have never spoken. And it kind of doesn't just look at the attacks themselves, but it looks at his entire kind of the infrastructure, I suppose, of his life and his business. How he managed to get away with it for so long, kind of incredible, really, how he managed, even when he'd been charged before, managed to plead something much much less serious. He would have been looking at life in prison, only served a couple of years. It's such an insane story, and we pretty much know that as it is, but I think to hear these stories over and over again from these women who were all victims of his, and to paint such a full picture over multiple decades, it's really well done. I mean, it's really grim. I mean, it will be, but it's really, really meticulously done. So I massively enjoyed that and would recommend it if you have a couple of hours free this week. Now, I tried to watch, at Boyd's recommendation, White Lines, which... You know, in
well,
many
my
respects,
semi-recommendation.
Semi-recommendation, which in many respects is right up my street. And I was like, Boyd says it's good, but it's nonsense. I can be on board for good, but nonsense. Like, I enjoy much stuff that is good, but nonsense. First things first, the accents. So somebody on Twitter did point this out. There's a lot of dodgy northern accents, very, very dodgy northern accents. It is so ridiculous. I mean, I made it like 20 minutes in and I was like, I have to turn this off. And I don't know if it was, the accents had a lot to do with it. There's a lot of bad northern accents. But it's just ridiculous. And I couldn't even get into the like absurdity of it and sink into that. I just, it made my skin itch a little bit. So I had to turn it off.
Oh dear.
So what, wow. I have not been watching.
Yeah, I mean, it is absolutely preposterous and the accents are terrible, yeah. I mean, it's both of those things are undeniable. I think if you get to the torture by a dance music scene, then that's a key moment, I think.
Yeah, I don't think I got that far.
Offensive okay. Northern stereotypes. This is your objection here.
I don't mind stereotypes. It's accents specifically.
where were they supposed to be from? Or was it just like the way I see the North? It's just
Manchester.
Like the Manchester. North. This is large.
Manchester.
I mean,
Manchester.
You have got Lawrence fucking Fox doing, sorry for swearing, doing a Northern accent. So yeah, I mean, it's embarrassing.
Yeah, it was no.
Right. Okay. Boyd, what have you been watching?
Well, I've got a few things, so I'll try and be quick on each one. Jeffrey Epstein documentary as well, I watched that, and yeah, it's incredible. And Graydon Carter, the former editor of Vanity Fair, has an interesting role to play.
Oh my God, yeah.
Yes. Isn't that fascinating?
Oh my God.
Yeah, that's so interesting.
Oh dear, Graydon.
Oh dear, indeed, yeah. So that was like my first takeaway from immediately from that series. And then, as Terry says, as it goes on, the testimony from the women involved is just incredible. So there's that. The other big show, the big documentary series that everyone is talking about is McMillions, which is on Sky and Now TV. It's on Sky's new Sky Documentaries channel, which launched this week. Now, I have no idea what the difference is between Sky Crime and Sky Documentaries and why this series, which is a true crime series, is on Sky Documentaries and not Sky Crime, but it is. Anyway, you'll find it. It's all on as a Sky box set. It's six parts, and it tells the story of the McDonald's in the late 80s, and for about 12, 13 years had this essentially like a scratch card game that you could win on based on Monopoly, and you'd win, take these Monopoly pieces. Yeah. And you could win $1 million basically with the best.
Or
if you got
more
the
likely
best.
A cheeseburger.
Yeah.
Right. Now, a group of people scammed this whole process, and they, for $24 million, they conned McDonald's out of $24 million by scamming the whole thing. It's a very complicated saga, how they did it, who was involved, loads of dodgy dudes called Jerry. But the incredible thing about this documentary, I think why everyone's latched onto it, it's the new Tiger King. A completely different kind of story, but to the extent that all the people involved who are interviewed throughout, who tell their stories, are eccentric, weird, egomaniacal, sometimes like really off-putting, sometimes incredibly likable and funny. They're all having a great time, most of them. The main FBI guy, who is called Doug Matthews, is like this slick kind of dude who's chuckling his way through the whole thing. Some of the stories are quite serious, you know, people being conned out of millions of dollars, blah, blah, blah. But he's having a whale of a time. And then there's this other character called Robin Columbo, who is a woman who was married to one of the key guys who initiated the whole thing. She's like a kind of stereotype gangster's mole, you know, in quotes. And she is extraordinary, chain-smoking her way throughout the whole series, a whole 6 hours. And she's one of the most incredible characters I've ever seen in a documentary series. So it is it is brilliant. McMillions on Sky Documentaries.
I'm assuming they ultimately go to jail. And if the judge during the sentencing did not say, go to jail, go directly to jail, do not pass go, do not collect £200, then they frankly missed a trick.
Exactly. And two other quick things. One is another documentary series on Netflix called Selling Sunset, which is in its second season and is this really cheesy kind of reality show series, like a kind of docu-soap about a real estate agency in LA where they sell these incredible, you know, all those homes above Sunset Boulevard in the Hollywood Hills, those spectacular houses on stilts and stuff.
Where Harry Bosch lives.
Yeah, it's the ultimate property porn, but it's also like the people who work for this agency are hilarious. It's run by two crop-haired dudes, twins, and all of their staff are like extraordinarily women who basically look like they've just walked out of a Miss World competition, basically. All of them. It's only populated, the real estate agents, by those women. And it's hilarious and brilliant, and the homes are incredible. And finally, one more thing is Ricky and Ralph's Very Northern Road Trip, which is Ralph Little and yes, indeed, and Ricky Tomlinson from the Royal Family reunited to do a Northern Road Trip travel show on the Gold Channel. And it's really enjoyable and really entertaining and really lovely. It's a celebration of the North, Terry. It's absolutely a celebration of Northernness. And it's just lovely to see these two from the Royal Family, one of the greatest shows ever, united on television.
I do a podcast with a living celebration of Northernness, so I'm not sure I necessarily need to watch that, but sure.
That's true.
I haven't seen that. I have finally got to Gangs of London and watched the whole of Gangs of London. I binged it over last weekend, and it really is as good as everyone has been saying it is. It's quite extraordinary. I do think it peaks halfway through. I think that's possibly the only thing. Like episode 5, which is slightly different from all the others, is one of the best episodes of television I've seen, but it is the high point for the series. And it's a shame that nothing that comes after quite matches those giddy heights, because that is, it's like a mini hour long action movie in and of itself. Well, it's a thriller. It's like, there's so much going on there, and it's really violent, and it's incredibly shot, and it's beautifully acted, and it's, you go through all the emotions, and it does, it's like its own little self-contained story. And I thought that was pure art. Like, that will be one of my favorite single episodes for the entire year. I think that's quite amazing. But yeah, I enjoyed it all the way through to the end. I thought it was very, very good. Chope DeRisu, of course, being the standout there, he's excellent. I'm not entirely sure why Joe Cole's accent is a bit Downton Abbey. I did discuss this a little bit with Chris Hewitt, and he was like, I think he's supposed to have shown that he's had like a posh education, but I was like, it's very, very posh. But very, very good series. I heartily recommend it. It is unspeakably violent, though I do think like a lot of the violence, like the large violent set pieces are quite front-loaded. Like there's a lot of punch-up stuff, and there's a big fight in the first episode, and then it does calm down a little bit with spikes of violence here and there, but it's not sustained carnage all the way through. Lots of love there. Tara, have you watched the whole thing yet?
No, I haven't. I'm actually tempted to go back, because it's been so long since I watched that 90-minute opener, to go back, watch that again, and do the entire thing in a binge.
It's well worth doing. I enjoyed back-to-backing it, actually. But yes, episode 5 is quite extraordinary. There will be a number, I think, of spoiler special podcasts on this very show, which are going to go out under the Empire Spoiler Special umbrella. We spoke to Gareth Evans. We spoke to Corin Hardy, who directed some of the best episodes of this season and appears in one episode as a busker. Spoiler. But those are not live yet. They are in the process of being edited, but should be up in the next couple of weeks. So if you are interested in listening to those, do head over to glow.fm/Empire Film and subscribe to the Empire Spoiler Special podcast channel. But yes, Gangs of London, excellent. I would say, Boyd, that is definitely in my top three of the year. One of the people on Twitter pointed out, yeah, Boyd, that your top three of the year so far includes 5 TV shows, so I don't know what those are, but
that is true. Yeah, that is true.
Oh, as it's the first show of June next week, should we do our halfway mark top five?
Well, that comes, Terry, at the end of June, our half year review, which I shall be talking to you about very, very soon. But yes, we are going to put up our best TV shows of 2020 so far in June. That will go up, which will be very, very exciting. Terry will, of course, have Devs at the top of hers, which will be good.
5 times.
Yep. Five Devs and, 5 Devs and Picard.
I was just going to say, your thing about Gangs of London dipping a bit after that episode, all I'd say is I thought episode 6 was astonishing in its own right as well. What I'm saying is the use of that song all the way through, that episode is incredible as in its own and in a completely different way.
Yeah, it's a deliberate gear shift.
Yeah, I think that shows how brilliant the series is. It's pretty extraordinary.
I quite like that device when done well, and it's rarely done well, where in a series they take you to a dramatic high point at the end of an episode where you cannot wait to see what happens, and then utterly shift down a gear for the following episode and don't show you what it is you want to see and show you something else instead. Yeah. And oftentimes that comes across as incredibly frustrating. And in this particular case, I thought it was excellent because they showed you something you didn't want to see and then showed you why it was better than the thing that you possibly wanted to see. Props to everyone involved in that show because it really is unbelievable. I'm not surprised that it set records for Sky because it's an exceptional show. Right, shall we transition now to our listener question, which this week comes from Andrew Young, who asks, what is the best single series of television? I'd put forth The West Wing Series 2, good man, Fleabag Series 2, and The Wire Series 4. What do you guys think?
Okay, so I agree on Fleabag Series 2. I just think it's, and we talked about this at the time, an absolutely kind of perfect season of telly. James, you will not be surprised when I say Buffy season 2.
Season 2 is an interesting one. Most people would say season 5 for Buffy.
No, I mean the Angelus Angel
becoming, isn't it? That's
finale.
Your...
The two part finale. It's among the best finales in television ever. That central storyline. The loss of Giles's girlfriend, like there has never been kind of a better, simpler iteration of good versus evil with Angel and Angelus. And then, the scene where she has to send him into the vortex to save the world. Oh my God. I mean, it's so overwrought and ridiculous, but I love every minute of it. The OC season 1. So I talked the other week about Dawson's Creek season 1, and I've been revisiting the OC actually. And I was like, actually season 1 is pretty much perfect and could have just stood on its own if they'd never done a season 2. It's just brilliant. The amount Ryan evolved in that one season. I don't think Sandy Cohen was ever greater than in that first season. I mean, Sandy Cohen forever. I still want him to be both my dad and my husband, which is weird. And Summer and Seth falling in love with each other, even if she didn't know it. But I have decided that the greatest single season of a TV show is series two of Doctor Who. This is series two post-revival. So series two is the 10th Doctor, who I talk about a lot, David Tennant. So here's why this is the greatest series of TV ever, right? So you've got David Tennant, the greatest ever Doctor, who arrives, obviously. It ends with one of the other great finales in TV ever, which is Doomsday. And then you have this perfect 13-episode arc, 15 if you include the specials, but I'm not. I'm just including the main series. That arc, which takes in him arriving, his relationship with Rose, and at the end introduces Donna Noble very, very briefly, Dr. Donna. It returned the Cybermen to TV, which was hugely significant. And also it contained some of the best standout episodes, I think, of Doctor Who, full stop. So not only Doomsday, but Army of Ghosts, Rise of the Cybermen, and The Girl in the Fireplace, which is exceptional. That is, for me, as close to perfect as you can get. And I remember, I think it ran October to July, you think 7 months every single week. And I cannot remember being so engaged with a TV show and having to be there in front of my telly every Sunday night, desperate, 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 and so invested and so broken and just like ash at the end. And I can watch this over and over and over again, and it never loses its magic for me.
Wow. A ringing endorsement. Boy, what were your picks?
Well, I think that I agree with Doctor Who completely. Yeah, that would be, it's definitely one of the most incredible series, yeah, that's ever been on TV. And my favourite series of Doctor Who as well. So I could fully endorse that. And I've for comedies, I've gone for Seinfeld, a series four, which was the series. Not only does that contain probably the best ever episode, The Contest, famously, where they're all having a contest to not masturbate, which is, if anyone's never seen Seinfeld, then that's the show to watch because it's so extraordinary. But that is the series which has a very self-referential, bearing in mind, this was the biggest show on American TV. And this whole series, the kind of arc of it, is that Jerry is getting commissioned to create his own sitcom with George called Jerry. And that goes all the way through, and then meetings with NBC and how the whole thing develops, culminating in the recording of the pilot episode, is absolutely incredible. And for a show, for a huge, big mainstream show, to have this really kind of clever and yet incredibly funny self-referential thing going on was groundbreaking and brilliant. The Larry Sanders Show season six, which was the final season, and that show got better and better and better as it went on. And the final season is all about Larry being reduced to a gibbering wreck because he knows that the network wants to replace him with Jon Stewart. And there's loads of incredible stuff about how American network TV works. And the final episode is incredible, which Jerry Seinfeld is in as a guest star. The Leftovers, I'm going for season two. I think season two, where they shifted the location.
Not three. Interesting.
No. Well, I think three, I think season two is like focused on the whole idea, the crux of the show, the show's main premise about organized religion and all of that. Mm. And whereas season three goes on incredible flights of fantasy and all of that, and it is absolutely phenomenal, but I feel season two is like where it is the most Leftovers of the all three seasons, if you see what I mean. So I love season two. Twin Peaks season one,
yes,
absolutely incredible. Mm. One of my favorite things ever. When I watched it at the time, I was like, this is just, never seen anything like it. Everything you wanted from that mix of David Lynch and an actual police show, thriller. Because it was still grounded, I think, season one.
Well, two was drivel, wasn't it?
Two was drivel, and the reboot was incredible. I mean, absolutely incredible. Mm. But season one was the perfect mix for me of kind of grounded and yet David Lynch weirdness. Beautifully matched. And my final mention, True Detective season one was absolutely, I loved that so much. And obviously it went off the rails at season two, season three went, True Detective, the first season, I absolutely loved every single episode of that, even up to the slightly controversial finale that people thought it went a bit off the edge. But I loved it. I loved every minute of that. It was absolutely brilliant.
And so I put a question to both of you. Which season of Friends would you pick if you could have one?
Oh, I'm going to say the one where hold with me because I just need to check which season it was.
Yeah,
I
forget which is which. Yeah,
because they all mold into one. The one is it season two where Ross and Rachel get together?
Yes, I believe it is. Yeah.
Yes. So the one with Ross's new girlfriend. Yes, because obviously it opens, that season mm-hmm. opens where Rachel's gone to the airport with flowers. That episode in itself is brilliant. Where she falls over, cuts her head open, and he introduces her to everybody and she's just being mental. That's incredible. The one where Ross finds out is obviously the amazing one. Obviously they then have the kind of breakup, don't fully get together, because he makes a list of all her pros and cons, like her fat ankles, and she's just a waitress. But then they eventually get together because that contains the one with the prom video, which is where they get together properly, when she sees the video of Ross preparing to take her to the prom when she thought she'd been stood up. And she kisses him against the door and Phoebe says, "See, he's her lobster," yeah, et cetera, et cetera. So I will say season two of Friends.
I cannot argue with your logic at any point there.
No. Mm. It's also got Eddie in it, the terrifying roommate, yes, which is hilarious.
Yeah. I think season two is the best of Friends. Definitely.
Season three was pretty great as well, just looking at it.
Yeah, very much a show that peaked early, Friends. It was always great, but it definitely, I think, lost some of its power. But then the characters evolved and they changed, didn't they? I think, but it changed in different ways. I think Chandler was at his best in season one and two, by far the best character. He became less good as he went along.
Yes.
And I think Joey and Ross were characters who got better over time. Like, and by the end, I think Ross and Joey had really found themselves. Ross is genius physical comedy, and Joey, who started off as kind of the butt of the jokes and actually became a really kind of interesting character in his own right.
Yeah, but I think Rachel was better early on, because I think season two and season three was obviously about the tension in her and Ross's relationship, and they kind of found a sweet spot where she was doing that, but also because Jennifer Aniston, I just think, has brilliant comedic timing, actually, and I think she's massively underrated for that. But in the end, it felt like she went full circle and went back to being that kind of annoying privilege. She didn't really have a lot of meat drama wise
all the Ralph Lauren stuff.
Yeah, all the Ralph Lauren stuff and the men, and she just never became that fully formed character. I felt like she was kind of season three-ish. And she just became slightly irritating. But yeah, I agree with you. I think Ross ended up being like just brilliant.
Yeah, completely. I've derailed this question. Sorry, Andrew Young. My answer to this. So he puts the West Wing series two. I'd agree with that. It does have 17 people. It does have two cathedrals. Some of my favorite episodes, stuff like A Proportional Response and Celestial Navigation, are in season one. But I think objectively, season two probably is the peak of the West Wing. The Wire, he said season four. I'd have gone with season three. It's a close call. But for me, The Wire peaks with season three. Season four is very layered, very subtle, and it's a very different season, as is two, actually, and that's often overlooked. But three, I think, is the sweet spot for the Stringer Bell goodness. If I had to pick a Battlestar Galactica season, I think even though season one has the single best episode in 33, I think season two probably, because it's got the Pegasus and it's got New Caprica, some great stuff in there. With the leftovers, I might go with three over Two Boy, but I know what you mean. Like, it's a very close call, and frankly, they're both amazing seasons. Breaking Bad, I would say the final season of Breaking Bad, season five, definitely.
Yeah, but I was going to say that. Yeah.
But that makes a certain amount of sense, isn't it? Because his descent from, you know, Mr. Chips to Scarface kind of has come to a head there. So I think you're seeing kind of the fulfillment of Gilligan's vision there, and I think that's great. Game of Thrones, I wrangled over this one quite a lot. Like, what would I pick for Game of Thrones? So season one in many ways, because there's so much good stuff there, and I think it's never neater, tidier, or more tightly compelling than it is in season one.
You're crazy. Season one, no way.
Season one has everything I love about Game of Thrones, which we've already established that your wrongness about Game of Thrones is legendary. But season one has everything I love about it, which is just its politics. It's like the West Wing with swords, you know what I mean? Like, it's very much focused on the world building and the politics and the maneuvering of the characters. Season three is good, obviously has the Red Wedding, but if I had to pick one, I wonder whether I might pick season four. So obviously that has the purple wedding, as it's called, Joffrey's murder at the wedding feast. It's got Tyrion's trial, the mountain and the viper. It's got Jon Snow fighting the wildlings on the wall and all the stuff with the grit, which is really powerful. It's got Brienne versus the hounds. There's loads of good stuff in there, and I think maybe the sweet spot for Game of Thrones might be season four. So I'm gonna put my hat on that one and claim that. And that's, broadly speaking, I mean, I could list all my favourite shows, but I will not bore these two or the rest of you with that. We will just leave it there. So, Andrew, thank you very much for that. If you would like your question answered, feel free to send it either to me directly on Instagram or Twitter at James C. Dyer, or sling it to Pilot TV Mag via Twitter DM, as I check those periodically when I can't find one elsewhere. Right, time now for our guest. Vicky McClure returns to our screens this week in Alex Rider, and she dropped into our virtual pod booth this week to talk about that show and a variety of other things with our very own Boyd Hilton.
Hello and welcome, Vicky McClure, to the Pilot TV podcast. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right, thank you. The sun is shining, so...
Yeah. Are you speaking us live from your home in Nottingham?
Yep. That's where I am. I'm in Notts.
Now, we're here ostensibly to talk about, mainly to talk about, Alex Rider, quite spectacular adventure spy thriller, but very much for young adults. Is this one of the first kind of YA things you've done?
Yeah, I think it is, actually. And actually, when the job was put to me, I'd not heard of it, which is kind of fine because of my age. It wasn't something that we studied at school. And then I asked my nephew, Kai, and said, have you heard of it? And he was like, yeah, as if I was the uncoolest auntie ever, which got me really excited because my nephews and you know, they can't watch anything I'm in because it's all pretty adult stuff.
Right.
So that really interested me. And then obviously I looked into, you know, Alex Rider in the books a lot more and just realised it's, you know, it's actually quite a beast already.
it's a huge phenomenon,
Yeah, it's huge. And, you know, I do like the fact that it's something that's for a completely different audience. It was really nice that they asked me, actually.
I've actually read the books, two of the books, because I used to do book reviews on the radio years ago, Simon Mayer.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And yeah, this was one of the kind of books we read was the first book in this series. And I have to say, from memory, this series feels much edgier, I would say, than the books. Is that, would you say, I don't suspect to answer about that, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't read the books. I wouldn't want to say either way, really, because I haven't read them, sure. So I don't know. But from what I've been told by other people on the project, that they are a lot edgier. And I think I'm kind of glad they are, just because they're not verging on anything that seems insensitive or anything like that. And, you know, for the amount of things that kids see now with gaming and, you know, television as a whole, I think we can trust them to enjoy certain things in a slightly more dramatic sense. And when this is being put out, yes, it's for sort of like children, I guess, but it's more young adults and children. And I think it will be a show that, given the circumstances that we're in, I think it's going to be a show that adults will be able to enjoy watching with their kids and with their teenagers. And often that's a sort of a tricky part of television to get, where you can both enjoy it, because, you know, as much as it's sort of the story is told by Alex and Otto, who plays Alex and Brennan. There's loads of adults in it. There's loads of different characters in it. So I think everybody will get something from it.
Yeah, and you play, so we should say, you play Miss Jones, Mrs. Jones, the brilliantly titled. Like, again, mixed up with Rising Damp's Miss Jones, who was an icon when I was growing up.
Yeah. No, it's... sorry, go on.
And she's the, kind of the handler, isn't she? She's a spy, but she's assigned to look after this teenage spy, Alex Rider. And she's quite I love the scenes between you and Stephen Delane. So Stephen Delane is your colleague. I mean, that first of all, that's a pretty amazing cast, isn't it, for a YA show? Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're kind of butting up against him, aren't you? And kind of, you're quite angry with him, I have to say. And those scenes are great, I think.
Yeah, it was great. Really great to work with him. He's such a lovely guy and a real professional, you know, wanted to make sure that we always discuss things in great length. And, you know, I'm always up for that because you'll find something when you're doing it. It's never a pointless chat sort of thing. There's a bit of a story that goes through the series where you can see that Mrs. Jones is conflicted with what she's doing at the department at MI6 with what she's doing with Alex. And as much as she's not quite the motherly figure, she certainly has a sort of responsibility towards him. And, you know, like in anything in life, when you start to get to know somebody and, you know, you start to care about them, this is the problem and the confliction that she has running through the show. And it, yeah, another great strong female character for me to play. So it was, and Stephen was great. Mrs. Jones, we sang that a lot on set. It was one of those. In fact,
it's a great song.
I'm trying to remember what her full name is. I always forget. She's got a really great first name, but because right. It's never referenced, it.
Yeah.
I'll have to remember that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But yeah, Otto will know. He's on it.
And Otto is the young teenage spy. I guess he's older than he is in the... Do you know how old he is? I was trying to find out how old he is, and it's quite difficult to find out.
He's in his early 20s.
Okay.
I don't remember.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to say what his exact age is in case I get it, one year, one way or the other.
Yeah, but he looks the part. Yeah, fair enough. He looks like a teenager.
He's not a teenager, and yet he's going to do fine in life. He's aging very well.
Yes, and he's basically playing a kind of young, I'm going to say a young kind of James Bond type character, isn't he, really? So he has to do all that action and stuff, and you're kind of there to look after him. How was he to work with, and did he take to all of that?
He was absolutely brilliant. You know, when you meet people that you know you're going to get on with, so that instantly just relaxes everything and makes everything quite easy. But what I love about Otto is he wants to have a nice time and he wants to enjoy himself. He's so polite. He's got all the manners. So he's a lovely person to be around, but he is so professional. He wants to get everything right. He did all the research. He worked so hard, and majority of the stunts that he had to do, he was always like, can I do it, can I do this, and wanting to get as involved as he possibly could. And you know, fair enough, because this could run and run and run, and you know, he'll have a long sort of job on his hands, and it's a massive deal for him. But I just loved how much he put into it, and it was inspiring, and it was helping everybody else to sort of gear up as well. And when you're working with people that are that hard working, you never want to let the side down. And nobody did. And it did feel like everybody was sort of excited to make something that is hopefully quite unique.
And it's got that, it's made, Amazon Prime showing it in the UK. And it's got that kind of big, kind of epic cinematic quality to it, hasn't it? When you watched it back, were you like, oh, did you realise it was going to be quite that spectacular?
No, I didn't. I genuinely right. didn't. I know when I was reading the scripts, I was like, he's doing what? And just thinking, how on earth are they going to film that? And, you know, way more ambitious than I expected it to be. And then when I watched it back, I was exactly like that, just thinking they've really gone to town. And it does feel like you've got a very sort of global series on your hands. You know, I've heard that it's been sold to many, many countries now. And so it's great. There's a chance for this to really, you know, spread itself across the world and hopefully get a nice sort of fan base behind it. We did Comic-Con last year. And even going there and doing the Q&A, there was just like so many fans, so many people already ready to see what this is about. And I hope, I think they'll be quite impressed with what we've managed to do with it.
Oh, I think so, yeah. Funny enough, it reminded me of not so much Line of Duty, but Action Time, one of my favourite things that you've done.
Action Time.
yes. The spectacularly funny
Tom
Davis show, where you're also playing a spy in a and I have to say, a weirdly similar set. Like
you
to the one
just
in
reminded me of that.
It's almost
that
spooky.
Is so how you, weird.
Yeah. So you've gone from playing like the comedy version of this role to the serious, very serious version of this role.
That's a
is
really
your approach very different from one to the other? Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah. That is a very different approach. I absolutely loved Action Team. I was actually quite sad that it didn't explode in the way that I hoped it would, because it would have been a pleasure to work with Tom on a regular basis. Yeah, that's weird. It is a bit, the set and everything, you're right, very dark sort of sort of basement-y type. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
Wow. But
do you approach, when you did that, because that was a very silly comedy, but you were playing it very straight. So in a way, I guess maybe you didn't alter the way you approach it to how you approached this show.
I wonder if they'd have seen it. Maybe they've seen this and gone, there's that girl. There she is.
Maybe. Yeah. One of the things I've loved, just today, in fact, in one of the best things about lockdown, I mean, there aren't that many, is your Line of Duty charity little specials. A new one went out today as we're talking on Tuesday, with guest stars and everything, are like hilarious. Now, and these are being done for the Ask for Mars charity. Was it just Jed McCurry's idea to just do these things? Is that?
Yeah, yeah. It was Jed. I think with Jed being, obviously he's a trained doctor, doesn't practice anymore, but he's got lots of contacts within that world, and I'm sure would have been communicating with people about what's been happening, and very aware that we are lacking in PPE. And just sort of said, you know, we need, it'd be great to get behind this campaign, and then just leave it to Jed to let him create something. And it, you know, I think he said at one point, like, has anybody got any ideas? And we were like, just you do it. Like, you know, one of the best writers we've ever had. And he did, and he wrote the first one that we did, which was great fun, and, you know, getting dressed up and trying to sort of like do the part. And then we did a little blooper reel. I think that was last week that they put together, which was great fun, and mainly sort of with Adrian Dunbar, who plays Hastings, which, you know, means that he's a very heavy blooper. And then that one, I mean, we literally shot it yesterday.
Wow.
So the turnaround is very quick. Jed was... sort of suggesting that we did another one, so I'm kind of hoping that it kind of continues.
They're so because, funny, just to see,
you know, why not? It's just it's nice to give some people something on social media to smile at, and it is a shame because, you know, we would have been wrapping up on series 6 very soon now, and obviously we've got a long way to go yet. So to give people these little fillers, and the fact that it's for something that we're all extremely passionate about, and it is so important, there's a really nice message with it, as long as, you know, along with being able to sort of create something for a laugh, and that's all it is, you know.
It's a nice way of keeping in touch with your colleagues as well, because you get to see Martin in his pool in Vegas. And
yeah, but the way we shoot it, we have to shoot it without each other. Do you know what I mean? Right. It's not like we're doing it like this. We have to shoot our bit, and then it all comes together in the edit with the editor that edits Line of Duty, actually. So, you know, it's all very professionally done. But yeah, we keep it. I mean, we've got WhatsApp groups, and we're all in touch a lot of the time anyway. So, but yeah, it always makes me, I'm always amused to see Martin's take, because I know he's going to be in the pool or by the pool or something like that. And then when Jed put in the script, Vicky sits in her onesie. I thought, that's the best costume he's ever given me. So I ran upstairs, grabbed my onesie, and then it said I was watching TV, and I thought, oh, I'll put the nest on.
That was brilliant. How good was the nest? Incredible, wasn't it?
Absolutely brilliant. And the figures that have come out about how well it's done, and you know, just a really great drama that gripped the nation again. And I love watching my mates on telly. So
this is England, which, you know, you did all those three series of with him and that film. But there are rumours that it's going to come, but that Shane Meadows is quite into doing a 2000 series. What's your feeling about that? Would you like to do it? Do you think it's a good idea?
My feeling is, I hope it, you know, stops becoming a rumor and becomes the real deal is the truth of it. I mean, I was only doing a Q&A with Shane and Chanel, who plays my sister, yesterday for this Nottingham festival that's going on at the minute. And again, it came up in conversation and we spoke about it. And, you know, the great thing about Shane is he doesn't do that, oh, I can't comment. He goes, I do want to do it. And this is kind of what happened. And somebody was asking if Combo would be dead or not. And he was like, I haven't quite decided yet. So, you know, he doesn't sort of play it down. He's definitely eager to do something. But it's like he says, it's when the time is right. And it's not yet. And he is writing something else at the minute. So it's definitely not sort of like imminent. But yeah, I mean, I just love it. I'd hope I wouldn't need to take my hair off again, but I'd love it.
Surely not. Surely that if it was set in 2000, over. I think you'd have hair, wouldn't you? Yeah, that's over. Hopefully. Yeah, that'd be fine. Yeah, that kind of Sunday lunch scene in the last series was one of the most incredible scenes in TV history, I think, the truths come out in that scene. Yeah.
Yeah, we spoke really in detail about that scene yesterday.
Oh, did you?
Q&A. Yeah, just.
Oh, we'll have to watch it. Okay.
Yeah, just recalling it back, and Shane that day was we'd sort of sat, all the cast had sat around, all the crew were outside, to sort of like not knowing what we were doing, probably thinking we're rehearsing, but really we was like talking about, you know, what was on telly last night. And this is kind of a common theme that we do. We just chat. And then we started to set up the scene, and Shane would usually go round and speak with everybody individually to make sure everyone knows what's going on, because obviously it's all improvised. And he wouldn't come anywhere near me, and it was driving me mad, because I was like, "Are you gonna? Can I have 5 minutes when you're ready?" And he was doing it on purpose, not to try and put things in my head or try and choreograph anything. So I did find myself upstairs in Lollan Woody's house in the bedroom, like really stressed. And then Joe Gilgan came in and was like, "You're right." And I said, "No, because I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what." And started talking about it to Joe as Vicky, but actually found it was probably what Lol would have done with Woody, because she didn't know what to say when she gets down there. So he's just a very clever man, isn't he?
Yeah, incredible. Yeah, that worked. Yeah, that plan worked very well. Yeah. Talking of line of duty, what's the state of play now? Are you talking about how, you know, resuming filming? Has that been discussed yet, can you say? Or, you know, how?
No, we haven't discussed anything in terms of this is the plan. The plan is we know that we need to go back, and they'll be in touch when that's going to be.
Okay.
I think we all know, just, you know, you only have to turn on the news and look around you. It's not safe to go back to work yet in that capacity. Obviously, lots of people are going back to work, and they're having to make lots of changes and adapt in lots of ways. And we're going to need to do that. And we don't really have the chance at the moment to facilitate something, to continue just filming as we did originally. So when it'll be, I just don't know.
And I can't imagine Jed's the kind would want to make a compromise about the way it's filmed, would he? He wouldn't suddenly want to, you know, change the way it's filmed.
Well, also, because of his medical background, you know, he's never going to make compromises full stop. He's going to want, his first and foremost will be, is everybody safe? And, you know, are we able to do it within those parameters? And if and when that comes, then we'll be okay to film. But it's like I was saying the other day, I don't know, because I don't know, I haven't spoken to anybody that's gone back to work in the industry as yet. But whether or not soaps are able to bring this into the story to make it a little bit easier for them to pick up a bit quicker, and the audience can sort of, you know, they're aware as to why those characters are socially distant, or aware of why certain things are happening, whereas it doesn't belong in the story of Line of Duty as it stands. So, and I, you know, whether or not he'd bring that in, I doubt it, but who knows?
No, I can't see it. Yeah.
No.
And finally, in this period of lockdown, and you know, being with your fiance Johnny, have the two of you been watching much TV? Have you been catching up with stuff? Have you binge watched anything that you'd want to recommend?
Well, I mean, we started obviously on Tiger King, as did everybody. So we did that. Johnny eats television and books. I mean, he's watching loads of things at the minute. I'm trying to think what I last watched. I've just started watching the documentary on, oh God, what's it called? Is it the Michael Jordan?
Michael Jordan, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that is incredible. Yeah.
I've just started watching that, so I'm looking forward to finishing that. I don't know. Do you know what? It's funny because so many people have maybe achieved an awful lot in this lockdown, and then I feel really bad that I've had days where I've done absolutely nothing and probably wasted the day. But in the same breath, I kind of go, I found it hard to concentrate sometimes, or to switch off, if you like. So I can't say I've just spent the last 7-8 weeks binging the telly. I hope there's not like a massive black hole of television soon, though.
Yeah,
it's great timing for Alex Rider, I've got to say.
It is good timing for Alex Rider, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Well brought back to the
No, but just generally, I think I don't know when they was actually planning on putting it out, but it feels like it's been brought forward. And
yes,
given that the youngsters are off school and there is the time for them to, and just, you know, television is an amazing escapism, isn't it? It does give us the chance to just sort of stop and not worry about whatever our worries are. And whether it's something you need to make you cry or make you laugh, you've got the options now. We've got channels galore, and Amazon's such a beast, and it's, you know, watched by millions of people. So hopefully it will give people a bit of escapism.
Oh, I think it will, totally, yeah. It's really good escapist fun, definitely. Vicky, thanks so much for joining us, and have a good rest of lockdown.
Yes, and you. Take care. Cheers, boys.
Thanks a lot. Take care. Yeah. Cheers.
That was Vicky McClure, and time now for this week's news. What's happening, Boyd?
Well, the BAFTAs are going to happen, the TV BAFTAs. So they were meant to happen in May, kind of last week, effectively, if we hadn't had a virus affecting the entire world. But what they've decided to do is go ahead with having a ceremony, but the one that's going to meet lockdown instructions. That was a terrible sentence. They're going to go ahead with the ceremony, but not have an audience and all of that and people there. So they're going to do it. They're going to announce the awards. Richie Ayoade is going to host it, which I think is a really good choice because he's great. And they will present the awards to the winners virtually. And I assume they'll kind of film those. And it's going to be on Friday, the 31st of July on BBC One. And I think it's good news. I think it's good to not postpone it forever and to reward, as the BAFTAs does every year, is the most prestigious TV awards in this country. So to dole out the awards, albeit in a kind of slightly weird version of the ceremony, is the right thing to do. And the nominations get revealed next Thursday, the 4th of June at 7:30 a.m. So we can talk about those on next week's show and complain about things that they missed and agree with stuff that they've got right. So that's all quite exciting.
Speaking of awards ceremonies, boy, did you see the sort of slight furore around The Mandalorian at the Golden Globes?
Yes.
So Pedro Pascal didn't get nominated. The Mandalorian got snubbed. But they then responded to that by altering their criteria to say that voice-only performances are now non-eligible in any acting category. So if an actor is playing a character, their face has to be visible to be eligible for a Golden Globe, which is yet another reason why the Golden Globes are fucking stupid. Which is honestly, the only thing I will say to this, on the one hand, it's you shouldn't have to see his face. It doesn't affect his ability to perform that role. It is a physical performance. It is a vocal performance. It is called acting. It is all of those things. That said, I think the waters get slightly muddied when you have, for example, an entire episode when he's not in the armor. So I wonder whether that then causes slight problems because it's literally not him.
Isn't that the problem? Because on one hand you go, well, it's not just a voice. Acting isn't just voice. Acting is so much about physicality and the way you move. But then it makes it properly, I think, a bit fucking depressing that there is a whole episode where he's not in the suit because therefore he's not playing the character. No. Because, every time, all superheroes with masks, they're still played by the same actor. Yeah. I think it's a bit of a, I think it's a bit disrespectful to the audience just to have somebody sub in like that. And to actors, really, because it isn't just about the voice and it is about how he moves. And presumably there were things he did physically with intention and deliberately to infuse the character with something. So I don't know how you really rationalize or justify having somebody else step in.
And it makes you wonder, if he wasn't in that episode at all, how much is he not in it elsewhere and they're just not telling us? Because I have no problem with other people jumping in for stunts. That's why you have stuntmen. Do you know what I mean? That's very, very common. It's absolutely fine. But an entire episode, and that episode is, there's a lot of talking. It's not a heavily action-based episode, apart from the finale of it. And yet he's not in it at all. I can't help thinking that that decision to do that and to not, reschedule the shooting, because I think he had Broadway commitments, was a slightly odd one. So while I do not condone this voice-only performances are not eligible, that's just ridiculous. Also, it's a disservice to, Boyd is now a BoJack stan. I don't watch BoJack Horseman, but by all accounts, some extraordinary performances of that. What, they're just now not eligible for anything.
Yeah, it's ridiculous, yeah.
Anyway, so that's the hoo-ha with the Golden Globes. But more important than that, I would say, is there's been some stuff going on in Amazon land. So specifically, the Lincoln Lawyer, which we talked about, had been axed by CBS. They'd got it already. It was cast. It was ready to go. They passed on the Lincoln Lawyer based on the Michael Connelly books, in part because CBS, as Terry will know, is a procedural powerhouse. They don't like serialized shows. They like standalone, jump in, jump out, promiscuous television. And the Lincoln Lawyer is not that and wasn't designed to be that. David E. Kelly had very much a serialized storytelling approach in mind. So that looked like it was going to die. But now Amazon may be stepping in to pick up the Lincoln Lawyer, which makes so much sense, not least of all because they're the home of serialized television, but also they own Bosch. And it's set in the Boschiverse, and Bosch is his literal half-brother. So, I'm seeing, this is now a TV universe. We can have a crossover episode. Bosch comes to an end next year. It's the final season of Bosch. So you can have Bosch can live on in the Lincoln Lawyer and everything is good with the world again. So yes, very excited about this. I very much hope this happens and I hope they make the most of it. That said, anyone but Matthew McConaughey playing Mickey Haller would not sit well with me. So I don't know, we'll see. Are you excited about that or do you neither of you care?
I don't care.
Well, that was totally convincing.
did you guys see the Upgrade that film? Was it last year now? What year are we in? Which was the Lee Winnall film. Yes. Mm. So I watched this even, and I did think it was pretty ridiculous, I have to say. If everyone remembers, it's the guy who his wife's killed in a mugging, he's left paralyzed. And then he's basically some STEM stuff and he could get revenge on people.
RoboCop. Yeah.
Essentially. Well, now it's going to be RoboCop, the TV series, because Lee Winnall's going to make a TV show of it with Blumhouse TV and the telly division at Universal. And it seems to be broadening it out, it says. It broadens the universe with an evolved version of STEM and a new host. And it's essentially the government is repurposing STEM to help curb criminal activity, which basically makes it exactly like RoboCop, which means I'm much more inclined to watch it. That sounds like a brilliant broadening of the universe to me.
So this is just your dream, isn't it? They've taken one of James's stupid sci-fi things and turned it into a police procedural. It's the best of both worlds.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Very, very good. Were you fans, either of you, of the Stieg Larsson books, the Millennium books, or indeed the films?
Yeah.
Yeah. So obviously Amazon are now
big time
doing a series based on the Millennium books, which famously were, you know, the girl with the dragon tattoo, the girl who played with fire, and the girl who kicked the hornet's nest, he says, trying to remember the three that are canonical.
Well,
and then the spider's web one is the one after he was dead. So that's not a proper one.
It's going to be a reboot, and the character will be transposed to the present day, and it'll be Elizabeth Salander dealing with what she does, solving crimes by hacking and being herself in the current world, if you like. So it's kind of like, it's an update.
It's just Elizabeth Salander, the series.
Yeah, very Amazon Primey as well, because that's what they do, isn't it? They kind of take these characters and they kind of create series built around those characters. I mean, she's an absolutely brilliant character. And I'm a huge fan of the David Fincher version. I think that's a fantastic, much underrated film, and it's kind of underrated because it is a remake of, because the first film, the original version of the first film, is pretty good as well.
It is,
but I thought his version was phenomenal with Daniel Craig. I love it. So I like the character. So I think it's interesting, and it's produced by the people who do The Crown. So it'll be quality, I think.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm looking forward to that as well. Like the books, enjoyed the films. Very interested to see what they do. This also love an Amazon book adaptation. Love it. This is my happy place.
Yeah.
So very excited about that. Do you see HBO Max launched in the US with 10,000 hours of content? This is their sort of Warner Brothers new streaming service, and looks set to be kind of a heavy hitter content wise, don't you think?
Yeah.
Huge. And what's this? But do we know any more about what the score is going to be over here, or is it?
I don't think, I mean, everyone's asking. I just don't think they've got any plans to launch it here at all, because most of the shows still have first refusal. Sky has first refusal, as I understand, on HBO shows, and they'll have acquired a lot of them already. I'd be amazed if it launches anytime soon here. It's too complicated. It's like much more complicated even than the whole Disney Plus situation, because they planned on having that being a global thing, whereas I think HBO, that is entirely aimed at their American market, it seems to me.
Because Sky would presumably not have any of this.
Sky will have a lot of it.
But what I mean is that they won't sorry, I should have worded that.
Sky would clearly
not want this to happen.
Yes, right, exactly.
Because if they lose their HBO stuff, they kind of have a rather severe existential problem, don't they?
Right, yeah, for sure. But I think we'll see, but it's going to take a frustratingly long time to see a lot of those shows arrive here, so people are going to get quite annoyed about it, I predict.
Mm.
We don't even know, like, the Friends reunion show, which is going to happen at some point. It was supposed to happen launch week originally before the virus. We've no idea who's going to show that, like, because that's got a complicated, you know, that's Channel 5 and have got the rights to show it, and, you know, so God knows what's to show Friends, so God knows what's going on with that, just as an example.
I don't expect to see it on these shores, but I'm in to see how. It's $14.99 a month. That seems quite expensive for a streaming service, doesn't it?
Oof.
Well, dollars.
It is, but they've got an incredible library. Yeah. Includes the whole library, and like they've spent a lot on new content. Use that word.
Well, that's significantly more than.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Yeah, because I suppose the next most expensive one would be Apple, maybe at $9.99.
Is Apple $9.99? I didn't think it was that much. I thought I had it in my head that it was only a fiver.
Or is it $4.99?
Might be $4.99.
Have I lost my mind? Well, then it's really expensive.
Right, and also Sex Education looking like it's going to begin production in August, which, frankly, I'm very pleased about, because there are very few shows that I feel I would physically actively mourn, that would pain me not to see return in its scheduled slot, and frankly, Sex Education is one of them. This was due to start shooting, I think, this month, and obviously was, you know, virused and shelved. But they're looking at an August start. Whether that'll happen or not, who knows? But that's the plan.
But I thought that was such a weird show to be one of the first announced to be returning to production, considering practically every scene is a scene of intimacy. Yeah.
2 meters apart.
How are they going to do that? How the fuck are they going to sort that?
I genuinely don't know, unless they work it into the plot line somehow. But I have absolutely no idea.
With these shows, I think they're going to do what they're doing with the football, which I won't bang on about, but the football season's coming back, everyone, June 17. And I think effectively teams are quarantined together and live as a kind of a household, if you like. Mm. And I think they'll do that with these production teams. It's the only way around it. They'll have to like get everyone together for a few months and just... And you know, be tested regularly. And I think that's the only way around a show like Sex Education.
But yeah, because I was... my boyfriend works in the crew on TV and film. And we were talking about this. And there's a lot of talk in the industry about it being really one of the only viable solutions, where you basically leave home and live and work with those people for 3 months, 6 months, however long the shoot is. But how does that work when people have families? Because it means they can't go and visit their families, they can't go home on weekends. So you'd be asking people to essentially check out of their normal lives for the length of the shoot, which means a large proportion of people probably won't be able to work, right? If they've got kids or, a life that they want to live. But yeah. I agree with you, Boyd. I don't see how else you could do it, because every time somebody leaves set for the night and comes back again, obviously you've got another risk. And presumably if you're testing, you'd have to test every day. Like, it just seems impossible with anything that, as you say, that doesn't take quarantining and the pandemic as kind of a narrative thing, which is the only way you could kind of explain why people went together. But the limits it places, not just on the technical side, you know, boom operators, for instance, and grips and hair and makeup, but also obviously the scenes actors can play together. If you think about how many times people actually stand 2 feet apart in real life, it's kind of nuts how we're ever going to be able to get around it.
Well, six people can gather together now, can't they? This is the new era. So we can all, 6 people can stand 2 meters apart in a garden outside. Yes.
But not go for a wee inside.
Not together. But then, Terry, frankly, that's not a good idea at the best of times, is it really?
But it says you can't go in the house.
You can't all go and wee together inside. All right, good
no, you
know.
Can't go and wee at all. You can only go in the house if you have to walk through it to get to the garden, but you can't go inside for any other reason. So you can't go for a wee. So if you have 6 people around your house,
they have to wee behind the shed.
They all have to take a piss in a hedge.
Wow.
That's true.
This is a fascinating insight of barbecue night round at Terry White's house.
Yeah. Bring your own sausages and your own toilet roll and dig your own hole to take a piss in.
Oh, God. Right. I think on that note, that is probably the end of news. So shall we move on then to this week's reviews? And we begin this week, appropriately, with The First Team, which we were unable to review last week. This comes to us from comedy geniuses Ian Morris and Damon Beasley, and charts the fortunes of a group of young players, including one unlikely American, at a British Premiership team in decline. There's a lot more to it, of course, but given my apocalyptically dismal understanding of football, I think a lot of it was lost on me. Boyd, was this one a righteous free kick or a dodgy sliding tackle outside possession that leads to an instant red card from the ref?
Well done. Well done, James. So this is from Damon Beasley and Ian Morris, the creators of The Inbetweeners. They've wanted to do a comedy about the world of Premier League football for quite a long time. It's the first thing they've done together since the second Inbetweeners film. So they've done different projects separately. Ian wrote and directed a film. Damon did another series, White Gold, which was on BBC Two. But this is their kind of they're reunited to create this show. And it's six parts. It's all on BBC Two already. I watched it in one big go. So, I mean, I'm a huge fan of theirs anyway. I was a big Inbetweeners fan. I love the way they know how... It's basically their speciality, let's face it, is dudes bouncing off each other. The horrible... I'm not going to use the B word, the banter word, but that was their speciality. And just observing the way men talk to each other. And they've kind of got that down to a T. And specifically to the language that men use, but going back to the Inbetweeners, obviously young, late teens, etc. This time, young, mostly young Premiership footballers who are in a unique position of Premier League footballers of being basically people in their early 20s to mid 20s mostly, who only work basically about an hour a day. Football training is about an hour a day, and that's it for the rest of the time. They can go off and do what the hell they want. So filling time, that's what the observation of this show is, that these guys get more and more, their sense of entitlement increases, their eccentricity and weirdness to kind of fill their lives with something not boring gets more and more important to them. And they end up doing just ridiculous, stupid, weird things. And I think all of that is absolutely true of the world of Premier League football. So I kind of completely took on that observation. It also focuses on the modern world of football to the extent that fan TV is a big thing. So I'm an Arsenal fan. Arsenal fan TV is a huge phenomenon of fans after every game being filmed and put on YouTube what they think. It's become this gigantic thing, and they use that very amusingly. So it's right on the button. It feels authentic. And yet it's very silly as well at the same time, and has a kind of that in-between the silliness to it. Will Arnett playing the chairman is great. I loved him. They wrote that role for him. I really enjoyed it. But what I would say is I think the first episode is the classic comedy scene set where they have to introduce quite a large group of characters and the setting and make sure portrayal of this world is authentic. I do think it gets much, much better as it goes on. And by the time I was in episodes 4, 5 and 6, I was absolutely loving it.
Terry, this strikes me as something that's right up your alley.
Oh, God. Okay, so I only watched episode 1, but I found this a real struggle, I have to say. I know nothing about football, but I just didn't think the jokes were particularly funny, and I didn't feel like there was authenticity in terms of the men and their relationship. So there's this kind of three lads, really, I suppose, at the centre of it. This new signing, Matty Sullivan, who's, you know, this great hope from America who's somehow accidentally been signed and actually isn't very good at football by all accounts. Benji and Jack, who were two lads already on the team. And as Boyd says, I was reading about it and Ian Morris had said it was exactly what Boyd just described, which is actually there's a lot of boring stuff in a footballer's life because you only do work for a short period per day, and it's that mundanity and repetitiveness of what do you do? Play Fortnite a lot, apparently, by the looks of it. Talk to girls on Instagram. So it's mainly set in the dressing room, at their houses, at the shops, when they go to buy a lifetime supply of toilet roll, a canteen. And so I found it quite boring, weirdly, which I don't know if that was deliberate because it was meant to be showing you kind of this mundane side to actually being a footballer. And I'll tell you what it did make me feel. It actually, for me, felt dated, not on the button. It felt the humour felt dated. The jokes, you know, there's a running joke about a guy, Petey, who's the psychopath in the team, and his really long foreskin, which is this running gag they keep coming back to. You know, there's this whole thing about one of them doesn't want to be seen to buy toilet roll because he doesn't want it putting all over social media and people thinking about him essentially taking a shit. And then he does go out to buy it, and it's like this comedy of errors. And I didn't buy the relationship between the three of them and the chemistry, and I didn't, the jokes felt really, it felt like kind of 90s, noughties, lad culture kind of stuff it was riffing on, which I just don't think feels relevant anymore, not for me. And, you know, let's just give mention to the women in this show, which is, you know, they're either mums, Instagram models, or there's a bitch of a PR woman. I think somebody online described her as a tutting ponytail, and that really made me laugh. I found this really hard to get on with.
It's funny, isn't it? I get what you say about it feeling dated. I wonder whether it's... So the in-betweeners, I think, works particularly well. Not least, well, they're very talented guys, these two, and they write very well. And I think the in-betweeners works because there's a universality to it. Like, everyone saw either themselves or people they knew in those characters. And that familiarity really made that work, and it made it feel comforting, and it made it feel familiar. I think I'm not sure how many people can necessarily relate to Premiership footballers. Perhaps Boyd can, but I don't know that world. And I think part of the problem is I don't know anything about football. So a lot of this was lost on me. I mean, this is a comedy about football. This could not possibly be more my kryptonite. So I didn't love it. It's not my sense of, you know, I quite like smug arch humor, and this is more, you know, sort of broad toilet based humor. It's very much not me. There are a couple of moments in it I did think were genius. Like, there's one bit which Boyd brought up with the interview with Will Arnett last week, where after he has signed the contract, and Will Arnett basically tries to see if he can rub it out, and he takes an incredibly long time to reach over and do it. And the genius of that scene is just how long it takes. Well, you just, I challenge anyone not to laugh by the end of that scene, because it's just so absurd. And I enjoyed that, and I think Arnett's a lot of fun in it. But again, this fails my Belen test overwhelmingly. And I don't really enjoy, know anything about, or have any interest in the subject matter. So I don't think it was ever really going to be a classic for me. While, of course, going in here, I was expecting to have the Archbishop of Banterbury drop by and it to be a bit like that, but it wasn't quite like that. Do you know what I mean? Like, the banter there didn't feel like the in-betweeners banter, which, again, it's really fast, it's really funny. There's a lot of stuff going on there. This felt like that foreskin gag in the first episode felt like it got more screen time than perhaps it deserved. It didn't go with me.
You can never give too much time to the foreskin.
Too much foreskin is what I'm saying. That's my poster quote.
But it is, I think it is a different to the extent that, because the in-betweeners was about a group of friends who are established. Do you know what I mean? Like an established friendship group. This is about a newcomer, the American guy, Jake Shaw. I think he's very likable, actually. So he's the likable outsider coming into this world where he doesn't belong, and he's trying to work out what the hell's going on and developing the friendship. So it's a harder thing that I think everything about this series is a really tough ask. I think they've set themselves a really difficult challenge to make it feel authentic, and to have this outsider figure to make it about this extremely lavish world of the ultimate, the ultimate riches for these young guys, and also to make it hopefully accessible to people who aren't interested in football. It's hard. It's really hard. And I'm not saying it's a runaway success and they've triumphed and they've done it. But I find it very, it's one of those things for me. It's like, once you get into the tone of it, and then you kind of really start liking it, I think, as it goes on. But I can see why Terry does.
But yeah, I think if the tone of something like this is not your cup of tea, like mine, I think you're probably just not going to get on with it, full stop. Yeah. I think if there is an affection for this stuff somewhere inside you, then, as you say, you know, other things I've read have said that it builds, it definitely builds better after the first episode. I will say that I very much enjoyed the cameo by Jason Williamson of Sleaford Mods, who is the kit man. And that is a beautiful couple of seconds of telly that really made me laugh and was so perfectly done. And he's just perfect in that. So I did enjoy that bit. And I did enjoy Will Arnett. Is that how we're saying his name? Will Arnett, I think, and you know, he's to have kind of a massive big hitter like him kind of in this show, I think it does a lot of good for it, because it gives it a kind of a quality edge.
It also has Chris Gear in it, who I always enjoyed in You're the Worst. He's always fun. And I enjoyed the coach, like the manager, whatever you call him, the Italian manager.
Cesare.
Yeah. I very much enjoyed the Cesare scene. I thought that was quite funny. And they do this kind of funny. Similar to the in-betweeners, it's kind of youthful naivety versus the real world, like, seems to be a thing that they do quite well. And there's certainly an element of that there as well. The whole of the first team is available now as a box set, and it airs on Thursdays on BBC 2. Next up this week, we have Amazon's adaptation of Anthony Horowitz's Alex Rider novels. Think Jack Ryan, but in a posh school uniform. The first novel in this series, Stormbreaker, was adapted for the screen as that slightly ropey Alex Pettifer novel back in the early noughties. But this series sees Otto Farrant as the teenage spy on a mission to save the world in an adaptation that skips right over part one and instead tackles the series' second novel, Point Blank, with some expositionary bits thrown in, as Rider sets out on this mission to infiltrate a shady French boarding school. Terry, is Amazon's spy series CIA or a pile of MI shits?
Oh dear. So this is a interesting one, right? So I remember the film, which was cartoonish and stupid and not terribly good. I've never read the books. You'll be gobsmacked to hear. And so I had in my mind this would kind of be a much more YA, I suppose, because that's what it is, right? So he's what, 14 in the books? In the books he's 14. So this was a surprise to me in many respects because they've aged him up. I think he's 16 in this, which is a kind of a crucial thing because he's on the edges of adulthood. And they've definitely, to my mind, tried to go for a much broader audience. So not just go for kids, not just go for YA. Adults as well as kids. So there's like one swear word, I think, said twice in the first episode. And it's much more slick and serious and kind of intense, I think, than I imagined it to be. There's some violence in there, which is kind of not, is quite unflinching. It feels a bit spooksy. What I really enjoyed is it's unapologetically British. So it's kind of transatlantic, this show, and there's the opening scenes are actually in New York. But the references are really British. He is absolutely a British lad. I think Otto Farrant, who plays Alex Rider, I think he's a cracking little actor. I think he's the right kind of, you know, he feels like a kid, but he does also have this edge to him. His friend Tom, who's played by Brennick O'Connor, who's in Game of Thrones, he for me is really the standout of this. So he is this brilliant kind of film nerd who is super awkward. Some of the stuff that makes it feel grounded in kind of a teenage world really authentically actually comes from him. There's a brilliant scene of him at a party where a girl pukes all over him. And I think he's actually brilliant. The kind of rounding out cast are incredible. Obviously, we interviewed Vicky McClure this week. I will say, and I feel like I say this a lot about Vicky McClure, I've only watched episode one, and she plays this kind of straight-faced handler in, you know, this association linked to MI6, who she kind of, you know, they say at one point they execute the intel that MI6 get. I feel like she's kind of wasted so far from what I've seen. We know how brilliant Vicky McClure is. It's a little bit Line of Duty Vicky McClure. So I suppose my thing is, the tone feels a little bit confused to me at points by it being so broad, because you've got this kind of spy plot, you've got this, you know, this shadowy school, which is at the heart of these murders that are happening. And it does seem to not kind of know whether it wants to be a really compelling YA story or a more adult kind of spy thriller. So for me, I wonder if it loses some of the flavor by trying to make it so broad and trying to make it appeal to so many people. But as a first episode, and as I say, that's all I've watched, I enjoyed I did enjoy how serious and slick, but there wasn't much fun. There wasn't much that really spoke to it as a YA property. So I think if that's what people are expecting, that's definitely not what this is. I'll be interested to see how it runs out across the entire season, but it's kind of sits in this middle ground for me. And I wonder if by going for that middle ground to get a wider audience, they've lost some of the spirit of what Alex Rider is.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? I expected this to be more YA as well. I was kind of thrown by how gritty it is. Like, it's quite, you know, a lot goes on, and you start dealing with, even in the first episode, they're talking about children being taken into care, immigration issues. Like, there's a lot of stuff in here that doesn't necessarily appeal certainly to the book's audience, which I think is about 10, 11, sort of broadly speaking, and maybe slightly older after that. It wasn't what I expected it to be at all. Boy, you must have known going into this that it was going to be slightly different.
Yeah, to be honest, I know a ridiculously large amount about this project because, weirdly, I have read the novels because I used to, back in the day when I used to review books every week on Radio 5 Live with Simon Mayo, we did a couple of Alex Rider books with Anthony Horowitz. And then I did the event with Anthony Horowitz a couple of years ago at Cheltenham Book Festival. And I remember him telling me about this TV version. This goes a long way back, the idea of doing a long-form TV adaptation of his books. And I think it's a deliberate move, absolutely, to they are much grittier and aimed at a higher age group than the books. And I think that's fair enough, though, because I think everyone involved feels that it's good to have a teenage spy. The fundamental idea is a teenage James Bond, and of course there have been teenage James Bond itself, but that's the idea. And I think it would be difficult. And I think the problem with the film was it tried to maintain that idea too much, and it felt cheesy and, you know, a bit silly. Whereas this, I think it fits a TV version of this book. This is the way to do it for me. So I think they've made the right decision to make it grittier and tougher. Because I think 11, 12, 13, 14 year olds watching it would not accept a thing aimed at a lower age. I think it's hard to do that in this day and age. I think all viewers are more sophisticated. I think by the time you're hitting, you know, even 10, 11, you're like, you're not going to take something that is clearly trying to appeal to a younger age group. So I think they've done quite a good job with the tone. I think it works. And I think getting Stephen Delane and Vicky McClure on board gives it, and Andrew Buchan, in fact, you know, who all of these are really good actors surrounding the core of Otto Farron, who I think I agree is really good. So I like I like the cinematic quality of it. I like the grittiness. Vicky McClure's character comes into it much more in episode 2, by the way. And the difference between her and the line of duty characters becomes more clear. Because I think she's a much, her scenes with, she butts up against Stephen Delane a lot. That's the thing. And their scenes together are really good. So she's trying to protect this teenager from the exploitation that Stephen Delane's character, it doesn't seem to give a shit about, basically. And that's a really interesting element of the show, I think, that, you know, they are totally exploiting this teenage boy for their own ends, and everyone is, so that it gets quite complex, because there's lots of different groups that are kind of fighting over him and his story and how he's going to be of use to them. So I think it's an interesting take on it, and I think it works really well.
Don't you think, Boyd, that the challenge, though, because I completely agree with you on the younger end of the audience, because, you know, it's like when we were kids, we weren't watching kids' films. You know, when I was reading magazines, I was reading Just 17 when I was like 10, right? So you always kind of punch up. I think the difficulty is arguably going to be converting an adult audience, because how do you get people like us, I suppose, especially when there is so many amazing thrillers, adult thrillers, how do you get an adult audience invested in a teenage spy, I think is the challenge. Because I think those kids are always going to be in. You know, there is the odd swear word and there is the odd bit of violence. I think it's quite exciting when you're 10, 12, 14 or whatever. But I suppose it's how you bring in those people.
Well, I think the answer is the things you mentioned. So I think, like, having the Brennock O'Connor's character being this really funny, likable, nerdy, film nerdy guy, I think that's key, because I think that kind of dialogue works really well. And on top of that, they've worked really hard at the storyline. I think it feels more complicated. I mean, I haven't read the book for, you know, probably 10 years or whatever, but it feels like they're really working hard to keep it a gripping, compelling premise. So, you know, I think it's absolutely aimed at Amazon Prime going, can we get 14, 15, 16 year olds, you know, on board? But I would happily carry on watching it. So I think it might work.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy for me to say, yes, I love the fact that they've essentially made this earthier and more real and sort of Nolanized it in a certain way, because obviously then it makes it more accessible to me, which is great. Like, this is a show that I would, I think, happily watch, because it was entertaining. I thought it was fun. It kept me engaged all the way through it. Whether or not I would let an 11-year-old, you know what, I think it's fine. 11-year-old probably be fine with it. I don't think it's necessarily a problem because the books aren't like, you know, like pre-tween, are they? They are that slightly sort of early teen novels. So, and I think, you know, I think it's certainly got a broader appeal to it. But it's got great people in it. It's got great performance in it. Even the way it's shot, though, is quite interesting. There's a scene where someone is killed in the first episode. And just even the way it's shot very dark and in shadow. And, you know, in a very sort of adult sort of movie thriller style, it doesn't feel at all like a kid's show, or even like the tone and the texture of it doesn't. So yeah, it's an interesting one, but there's some humor in it as well. I think they did a good job with this, and as ever with Amazon's book adaptations, I'm a fan. I think they kind of hit their strength with this, haven't they, taking these sort of literary characters and then, as you said earlier, just sort of spinning them out into an entertaining series. So I hope this one will do well.
We probably should mention that the director is Andreas, hopefully I'm saying this right, Andreas Prochaska, who did Das Boot. And I think that gives you a sense of some of the tonal sensibilities and that kind of the dramatics and what do I want to say? Hang on. I suppose in the way it's shot and the tone of it we've been talking about, that is kind of a good reference point for what you're going to get.
Indeed.
By the way, it starts on Thursday, weirdly.
Okay.
It arrives on Thursday.
Okay. Alex Rider arrives on Amazon Prime on Thursday, the 4th of June. And next up this week is The Other One, a BBC comedy in which philandering father Colin Wolcott dies, revealing to his terribly middle-class wife and daughter that he has a secret second family and, worst of all, they're working class to boot. The two families are thus thrown together and much hilarity ensues. Or does it, Terry?
So, this actually was a pilot back in 2017, which from everything online seems to have actually been really well received, but it's only kind of now made it to full series. As you say, that it's a very basic premise. It opens with a man having a surprise birthday party. He walks in the door of his own birthday party and starts to make an excuse of having been for a drink with a mate. The mate is part of the surprise birthday party and is hiding in the kitchen. At that point, the penny drops. He's about to be found out as being unfaithful, and he basically collapses and dies of a heart attack in the kitchen. That isn't a spoiler. It happens immediately. When this happens, basically at the funeral or just before, it's been discovered that he's got two families. So he's got the middle-class family who he spends six nights a week with, and he's got this very working-class family who he spends one day and one night a week with. Now, there's a joke in it that, you know, some men, when they have a mistress, buy both the wife and the mistress the same perfume to avoid, you know, being caught out. His version of this was he called both his daughters Catherine. So he's got these two daughters born 5 days apart. One calls herself Kathy. That's Ellie White, who's been in Inside Number 9, the Windsors. And she's kind of the middle class Kathy. And then you have the working class Catherine, who is Lauren Socher, who's in Misfit. She's the amazing babysitter in Catastrophe. And yeah, so basically these two families, these two wives and daughters meet, and it's about their kind of burgeoning relationship. It's not actually about him at all. It's about these four women. The mums are played by the amazing Siobhan Finneran, who we talk about quite a lot, the Downton Abbey, Happy Valley, the ridiculous thing on Netflix recently. Help me out.
The Stranger.
The Stranger. Who seems to be able to turn her hand to anything, I have to say. And Rebecca Front, who's the thick of it, War and Peace, they play the two mums. And I think the strongest thing about this is just the performances of those four women. They are all phenomenal in their own different ways. So, you know, Kathy is middle class. She's got this awful fiance. She's got a pension. She's got a boring job. She's quite frigid and quite meek. And then you've got Kat, and she is, you know, she works for Deliveroo. She's got, you know, all the signifiers of being working class. She's got a pay-as-you-go phone. She's single at the moment, she says, after having completed Tinder, which was a brilliant line. And the mums are different again. So, you know, Siobhan Vinna and her character, she talks about she smokes constantly. She talks about how she kind of, she said, oh, I hate fresh air. It dries me out, which is a line that just made me, like, my skin shrink. And the four performances are so different and the chemistry between them, I just thought was lovely. Because in some respects, I was worried it was a bit of a crass way to draw it. You know, a very typical middle-class family, a very typical working-class family. But the performances, they give such kind of humanity and layers to these women. It's created by Holly Walsh, who did Motherland. She writes it as well with Pippa Brown, and the writing is brilliant. There are so many great lines in this. You know, there's a bit where Siobhan Finneran says, oh, you've got his lovely eyes and she got his lovely arse, to each daughter. And they just, the lines are so realistic, so well observed. And in many respects, it's kind of a classic sitcom because it's that kind of odd couple, yin and yang, and how they rub against each other. And there's kind of hints that there may even be another family. I really like this, and it kind of really grew on me. I watched the pilot. I watched the first episode of the proper series, and I just really enjoyed the kind of simple setup, which is it's really the gap between these two families, the gap between being middle class and working class. And that's where all the humour and all the humanity lies. So, yeah, I think this is really good.
Yeah, there's a scene in episode one. It's confusing. So the pilot, it's effectively, I think, seven episodes. There's the pilot and six episodes.
Yes.
Filmed later are all going to be up as a box set as well, I think. So there's a scene in the first episode proper, not the pilot, where Laurence Socia's character is like, how can we have organized this party, let's have a phone party, and Ellie White's character says, yes, that is definitely something to mull on. And there are these moments where the two of them, and I love the fact that, as you say, it sets up this class conflict idea, and it is very almost gently dismantling the stereotypes and the cliches that you expect it to. Like, the traditional sitcom version of this story would absolutely run with, you know, from the 70s or 80s. And that's what I think this feels to me, almost like the premise of the whole thing is for Holly, who created it, is, you know, what if we do this really, as you say, this really kind of classic sitcom idea premise with loads of comedic potential, but kind of make it believable and real and not stereotyped. And I love the way they're doing that. And so there's a bit where Laurence Socia and Ellie White's characters, these two class conflict type, completely different, they suddenly order the same food. And I thought that was such a clever little moment to show, they might be completely different on surface, but actually, funnily enough, you know, they've got an incredible amount in common. As you say, the cast is incredible. My favourite is Rebecca Front, because I love, Rebecca Front's brilliant in everything she does, but she's kind of bitter and twisted in this, and she's loving it. And just the kind of joy with which she's approaching this character, I think, is fantastic. As you say, Siobhan Finneran, always brilliant. I do think it's really great. And I think the writing is really clever. I think Holly Walsh and Pippa Brown have done a brilliant job. I'm really, really enjoying it. Yeah, it's great.
James, I don't think you're going to like this, are you?
It's not my cup of tea, is it, really? Bear in mind, I only watched the pilot. The story is kind of disposable. It is a scene-setting episode, to be expected. Like, there's a lot of them driving around working out what to do with his ashes. And I think I was slightly bored because I wasn't particularly entertained. I didn't find it very funny. And I wasn't really that interested in where it goes. And I didn't find the characters irritating. I just didn't find them compelling. I was also slightly distracted by the fact that, and this is almost certainly entirely me, Ellie White, who plays Kathy, reminds me of Joe Thomas to the extent where I almost couldn't get past it, in that her cadence, her voice, her every delivery is like a female Joe Thomas, and I found it really distracting. But I mean, I do like Siobhan Finneran. I think she's very, very good. Big fan of her in Downton Abbey. It's just not for me, I think, is the answer to this. It's just not for me. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I can't pinpoint anything. It just did not entertain me. Sorry.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Not a shocker.
I was never going to love this one, though, was I? It was never really.
No.
It's certainly not one that's aimed at me. It's about as far away from my sense of humour as you can possibly get. So, the other one, indeed. And that airs on BBC One on Friday, the 5th of June at 9 p.m. Finally this week is Cardinal : Until the Night. Now, this is actually the fourth series of this Canadian cop show, but the first one to land on BBC Two. Don't panic if you've not seen seasons 1 to 3, because it really doesn't matter. These are based on the novels of Giles Blunt. There's a new case each season because they're kind of based, each season is based on a different book. You don't really need to have seen the other ones at all. Billy Campbell stars in this as Detective John Cardinal, a Canadian super sleuth. And in this particular mystery, Until the Night, he's tasked with tackling the kidnapping of a prominent politician's husband. Boyd, what did you make of this one?
Well, I'm a fan of this kind of show. It's basically, so this has been a big kind of cult hit on BBC Four. All the previous three seasons have been shown in the classic BBC Four Saturday night foreign import slot. You know, The Killing, they started it and they've shown all kinds of The Bridge and all those. And now it's transplanted to BBC Two, which, by the way, I think is really interesting because I get the feeling that they're transplanting a lot of classic BBC Four type shows to BBC Two in preparation for either ditching BBC Four entirely or, you know, turning it into just a kind of archive channel, because this is absolute BBC Four, literally BBC Four show that has now been, like, you know, there's rock documentaries now on Saturday nights that absolutely should be on BBC Four. Anyway, this show in itself is, I feel, right from the start, it was like, shall we create a Canadian set mystery in a Scandi noir style? So the whole thing is massively influenced by those Scandi noirs. It's literally snowy, icy, chilly. The interiors are like Scandi noir, as well as the exteriors. The tone of it, it's the way it's shot. It's got that kind of brittle, tough, icy quality to it. Even the characters, like the police boss character, Billy Campbell and Karine Vanessa, the two main detective duo, but their boss is kind of very, very Scandi noir. And I love that stuff. So I love the whole genre. I'm completely on board with this kind of thing. So the question is for me is this series going to be as compelling as previous ones? And I think the story, I think it started off pretty strongly. I think it's interesting to have a story about a prominent politician's husband going missing and the way that he's discovered, and the already they're setting up a very interesting set of circumstances. And that's all. I've only watched the first episode. I would say it doesn't feel like it's outstanding and amazing particularly yet, which is probably would be the case for the fourth season of something that's kind of been it's a show that's worked on a lot of levels, but it's not incredible like The Killing or The Bridge or something, but it's a really I think it's a really compelling, enjoyable show, and I'll definitely carry on watching.
I know what you mean about the Scandi influence. Like, yeah, this is one of those things where I like, you know, whether it be Wallander or any of those kind of based on a series of crime novels type things, I really enjoy the format of taking a really tightly wound crime novel and then unspooling it over one season of TV. And I like Billy Campbell as well, so this is really good. It doesn't skimp on the violence, which I thought was a little bit shocking in places, but also I think it works very well for this show. But I don't know the author's work particularly well, but I think this feels very much like one of those ones where he's quite stingy with the information, where the story very gradually unfurls. You're quite in the dark, perhaps a touch confused early on, and then it becomes more compelling as the light begins to shine on what's actually happening and starts to come into its own. I think by the end of the first episode of this season, I think you have an idea, perhaps where you think it might be going. Whether it's actually going there remains to be seen. But yeah, by the end of this first episode, I was like, I'm definitely going to watch another one of these. I have to now see how this ends, because it really drew me in. I enjoyed this an awful lot, which is amazing because I'd never, ever heard of Cardinal before we did this. And I now kind of think, well, I'm going to watch this and I might go back and then watch the preceding three seasons as well. Terry, there's grimness and murder in this, and it's set up north. I mean, the north of North America, but sure. So did you like it?
I did. It's weird coming into something at season four. Sorry if you've already said this, but are they putting the first three on iPlayer as well? Do you know?
Do you know what? I'm not 100% sure. I'll find out.
Because it made me want to actually go right back to the beginning. I hate coming into things, especially a final season. So there's obviously a lot you kind of are just assuming. Like, I enjoyed the relationship between the two detectives, Cardinal played by Billy Campbell and Delon played by Karina Vanessa, I want to say. I enjoyed their relationship. I enjoyed their chemistry. I was immediately kind of desperate to know the backstory of their relationship, which there obviously is quite a complicated one. it's very slow paced. We've talked about this recently with a lot of this kind of peak TV about how it's this slow pace, as James says. They kind of reveal things quite slowly. I enjoyed the location as character. So, you know, as exactly what you said, Boyd, it's so brittle and cold and hushed, and it gives it this really kind of quite incredible feel. I mean, it looks fucking fantastic, we should say. Like, it is properly good looking, really kind of, as we say, hushed and slow and deliberately paced. I found it really hard to get over the fact that I was joining in the fourth season. So I think I'm going to go back. I'm going to stop now and go back and try and watch the entire thing.
They are all available on iPlayer, by the way. Yeah,
great. So that's my recommendation, would be, if this sounds up your street, kind of try, if you've got the time in this lockdown, is to go and start at the beginning, because I immediately wanted to know more about their relationship. I don't think you have to be able to watch this, because it is a self-contained story, this mystery that it opens with. I will also say that the violence is very inventive. I enjoyed that. Yeah. I was like quite surprised by some of what I saw on screen. And I don't think you're surprised by much these days, but it's clearly there's imagination and real kind of really interesting things done on screen. But from one episode, I'd say, you know, if this is your thing, if Scandi noir is your thing, because as you say, it's basically Canadian noir, then this seems good, but I can't really go any further than that.
Okay, well, Cardinal drops on BBC2 for the first time on Wednesday, June the 3rd at 9 p.m. And you can watch seasons 1 to 3 on iPlayer. Also out this week, there are a few things, aren't there, Boyd? Including, I believe, Netflix's 13 Reasons Why, which starts its final season on Friday, June the 5th, which we have not been allowed to see.
No, and I remember they did this with season 3. I think this is quite a special case, actually. I think they would, because 13 Reasons Why became a very controversial show, because it showed a character taking her own life in too much detail. A lot of people said they went back and re-edited that scene, remember, famously?
Yeah.
And season 2 had a very shocking sexual assault at the end of it on one of the male characters. So it's a very controversial show. I think they're wary of letting people see it in advance. So that's, I think, why we haven't seen it in this case. This is the fourth and final season. I mean, I think it's a show that has, I kind of enjoyed it, or enjoy is, well, you know, it's been very, very bold, let's put it that way, for a kind of quite a soapily toned teen drama. It also has moments of incredible boldness. So I'm interested to see what happens in the last season.
Yeah, we'll see. I stopped. I didn't watch season 2 of this, so I've long since lost track of it.
Season 2 was terrible, famously, but season 3 was pretty good, I have to say. I thought it brought it back for season 3.
Okay, anything else that we missed?
I don't think so. I think that's
Amazon's
mainly
showing
it.
This Is Us, though. I don't know. Is that a new season of This Is Us? Or?
Oh, yeah. That is the new season. Sorry, yeah, they are showing. And This Is Us is like still the biggest show biggest scripted show on American TV, by the way. But kind of Channel 4 showed season 1 of This Is Us, then they lost interest, so they didn't do very well. And now it's become an Amazon Prime thing. So yeah, I think fans of This Is Us have been waiting until now to see this whole season that I think they're showing from Friday.
And the new season of Shonda Rhimes' How to Get Away with Murder is landing on Sky Witness, isn't it? Is that on Thursday?
Yes.
And that's Thursday, yes. June the 4th at 10 p.m. So what would your pick of the week be? I can't predict this one.
Mine would be the other one.
Boyd.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Mine would absolutely not be that. I would go probably with Alex Rider, or failing that, any other show that isn't the other one.
Whoa.
James.
Right. Anyway, before we say goodbye, shall we have a quick banshee of a classic show that we wish to dredge up for modern audiences? So I'm going to go first on this one, because I feel I have a wrong to address. You'll remember I recently spoke, I think when we reviewed, God, what was it, Pandora, when I mentioned I had a And I think the quotation was, I said, I've got a very high tolerance for shit sci-fi. I've watched every episode of Babylon 5. The amount of shit I got on Twitter for having besmirched the good name of Babylon 5 was quite extraordinary. So I think you're only allowed to say Babylon 5 is a big pile of shit if you're quoting Simon Pegg in space. Other than that, thou shalt not do it. So to kind of right that particular wrong, because I don't think Babylon 5 is a big pile of shit at all, I thought I would banshee the one, the only Babylon 5. So this ran for five seasons from 1998. It's J. Michael Straczynski's show. And what sets this show apart, what makes this show relevant, what makes it important, is it was, I think, perhaps the first seriously serialized science fiction show where it was conceived and executed as almost like a televisual novel. Like, it was the whole story was planned out by Straczynski from the beginning. He knew exactly where he wanted to begin. He knew exactly where he wanted to end. It was a 5-year plan, and he wanted to tell this whole story. Now, naturally, this made the network very, very nervous. Their whole thing was, I think, that if you put a show out into syndication, which obviously makes them a lot of money, they're going to air it out of order, and that won't work for this. And they also use that sort of hoary excuse where they say the American attention span will not survive this. They need self-contained episodes. No one wants to wait 5 years to hear how a story ends. So it turns out they were wrong. Now, Babylon 5 was the idea that there'd been a huge sort of interstellar conflicts and war. So this space station, Babylon 5 itself, the space station, was set up as a kind of diplomatic hub where alien races could meet and mix and talk to each other and get along. The last best hope for galactic peace, as it were. And you had all sorts of different characters in this. You had the Narn, the Vorlons, the Centauri, all these different races that kind of came together. Boyd's rolling his eyes at this. Did you ever watch Babylon 5, Boyd?
Yeah, I watched about...
You weren't a fan of it. You probably jumped in the middle, didn't you? You had to watch it from the beginning. So this was a funny one. So it started off with Michael O'Hare in the lead as Commander Sinclair in season one, but Bruce Boxleiter took over in season two as Captain Sheridan, and who he was a lot better. And the series kind of played out, and it evolved as it went, and the shadows with this nefarious kind of alien sort of malignant force. And the plot sort of took on this large sort of galaxy-spanning storyline. You had the rise of authoritarian regimes on Earth. Lots of things happened, and all of this was planned by Straczynski from the start, which is quite extraordinary when you think about that just wasn't the done thing then. Not least of all, because that's the way network shows are produced. They never know when they get another season. But to actually have this whole show plotted out from the beginning was so ambitious and so bold and so groundbreaking that, you know, shows like The Expanse now, well, they're based on books, but, you know, shows like Rondi Moore's Battlestar Galactica or the latter series of Deep Space Nine, they all took their lead from what Babylon 5 laid out, which is that serialized long-form storytelling can really, really work. And so much TV nowadays follows a similar format to that. Babylon 5 was also an interesting one because of budgetary constraints. They couldn't afford the miniatures the Star Trek The Next Generation used. They couldn't use the little models. So they instead opted for very early CGI. So one of the reasons Babylon 5 has dated so badly is the CGI is fucking terrible because all of their exterior shots are done on a computer, done on a Commodore Amiga, amazingly. And they look really ropey. It's absolutely true. They look really ropey because of it.
I think we might have reached peak nerd,
no, but
by
the way. I'm serious. Like, you know, that was a really big thing. Nowadays, CGI is a whole big deal. It wasn't something done on TV then. It was all miniatures, and they did it for budgetary reasons. But, you know, again, slightly groundbreaking there. Now, the thing with Babylon 5, which kind of threw a spanner in the works, is so he had this 5-year plan, but they had a bit of a wobble when he was doing season four. They weren't sure they were going to get the fifth season. So his whole 5-year plan then became an absolute nonsense because he needed to finish the story. So he ended up moving a lot of the stuff from season five into season four. And he shot the finale of season five when he was doing season four in case he never got to do it. So in the end, they commissioned a bunch of TV movies and he moved some of the plot stuff into the team. It became a little bit muddled. There was a spin-off series called Crusade, and he did get a fifth season in the end, but I can't help thinking if that had always been the case, if he hadn't had to mess with his plans, the story would have been a bit neater. But it got a bit bumpy in season four and five just because the network dicked him about so much. But nevertheless, I thought this was an incredible bit of television, certainly for the time. It was really, really bold. But yeah, Babylon 5, not a big pile of shit, actually a groundbreaking landmark piece of science fiction, which while looks a bit daft by modern standards, sows the seed for all the great TV that we watch today. Respect it, love it. Babylon 5. You can buy the box sets, the Babylon 5 box sets of all the various TV movies, The Seasons and Crusade, the spin-off. You can get them all secondhand for peanuts. Or you can buy them on, you know, digitally on Apple, Amazon, Google, whatever it is. You can't stream it anywhere, to the best of my knowledge. But if you want to see the great granddaddy of all the sci-fi that you love now, you could do a lot worse than sitting down and watching Babylon 5. And that is my banshee. Neither of you are going to go out and do that.
No.
Terry, I would pay good money for you to sit down and watch all five seasons of Babylon 5.
I mean, kill me now. Can I choose death over that?
Go on then. What's yours?
So there's something on BBC. We've been watching it on iPlayer at the moment called Limmy's Homemade Show. Now, this isn't what I'm going to banshee because this is currently on, but this is the Scottish comedian, and he actually did this homemade show, I think, a year or 2 years ago as a one-off, and it's where he basically, as it sounds, makes a show entirely himself in his flat. He's the writer, he's the producer, the editor, and now he's brought it back during lockdown because obviously it's perfectly made for lockdown. But it actually set me off watching Limmy's show, which is different to Limmy's homemade show. Now, Limmy's show is on Netflix. Outwardly, this should be, this was on the telly and I caught it and I was like, what the fuck is happening? Who is this guy? Why is he so irritating? And then I just found myself really compelled by it. So anybody who's either, you know, seen Limmy on Twitter or caught any of his stuff knows it's really surreal. It's quite brutal. It's not kind of, you know, classic comedy. It's kind of, I suppose, classic sketch show comedy, but it is more twisted, more dark. He really focuses on kind of life in Scotland, in Glasgow in particular. His characters are like, you know, there's a stoner, Dee Dee, who's my favourite character. And there's one whole episode, I think it's season two, episode two, where Dee Dee takes a bus journey, and that's the entire kind of plot of the entire episode. And it's just so brilliantly done. There's another one that's a hard bitten ex-junkie. There's a phone-in host. These are all kind of the characters that make up this sketch show. And actually, when you watch it, it's absolute genius and really funny in such a dark, twisted, weird way. And since I kind of stumbled upon it, I think it's from 2011, 2012 it started, I've just like nailed all of them. There's series two and series three on Netflix at the moment. And then if that's kind of your cup of tea, James, you would absolutely hate it. Then there is also, as I said, there's Limmy's Homemade Show on, which is currently on iPlayer at the moment. And is that out, actually going out on TV as well, Boyd? Do you know?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Which channel?
BBC Two, Sunday nights, okay, off the top of my head. Yeah.
And yeah, Limmy's Homemade Show, they're all going up on iPlayer, but they're also on Sunday nights on BBC Two. But the old good stuff is all on Netflix for you to watch.
He is an amazing figure, Limmy. Yeah, he's,
isn't he?
He's the way he uses social media. I mean, he's kind of, I think he's deliberately eased off Twitter a bit. But back in the day on Twitter, I would say like 2 or 3 years ago, he was phenomenally, he was like terrifying. You wouldn't know. His comedy was so edgy and challenging that you would not know how to take half the things he said. And I think that is definitely there in his shows as well. Yeah. So
and the incredible. I mean, everything's kind of the mundanity of everyday life in Glasgow.
Yeah.
But he makes it so surreal and out there and goes to places you would never imagine. And some of it's quite horrifying, but it's really, really interesting and just really funny. So yeah, James, you would hate it.
Excellent.
You would hate it, James. Yeah, I can confirm. I've gone for, you're about to ask, Drifters, which was a Channel 4 comedy created by Jessica Knappett. It was produced by Damon Beasley and Ian Morris, which is why I was reminded of it, of the first team and the In Between Us fame. When it came out, it was regarded as in a kind of simplistic way by pretty much everyone who reviewed it as the female in between us, because it is about a group of young women finding their way in life. This is like they're older, so they're in their early 20s, but it's definitely like they've finished college or whatever. Now what do they do? Trying to get work, and they're drifting literally from one rubbish job to another. It stars Jessica Knapp herself, Lydia Rose Bewley, and Lauren O'Rourke as the core trio of women. They're all absolutely brilliant. Bob Mortimer is in it as Jessica Knapp's character's dad. Nick Mohammed's in it. Brett Goldstein is in it as their neighbour. I forgot about this completely since I went back and kind of researched it again. Among the writers of the series, there were four series of Drifters, and I don't think it ever became a kind of phenomenon that it could have been. Phoebe Waller-Bridge worked on it, and Emerald Fennell worked on it, her mate from, you know, from Killing Eve. And it was really, really good. It was like, it was incredibly fun. It was not like trying to be, make any great point, but it was really, really funny and brilliantly performed and really well written. And I remember enjoying every single episode of it, and all 24 episodes are on all four, and I would urge people to check it out.
Drifters indeed.
James was drifting off then.
I was
indeed.
I can
literally see you drifting off. Considering your description of Babylon effing
hang
fire
on.
Yeah, for about
hang
an hour.
On. You cannot have a go at me for drifting off while you're talking about Drifters. When I was talking about Babylon 5, Terry wasn't even looking even the vague direction. She was doing something entirely separate, as I might add, were you. You were both just doing other things, checking emails, maybe doing a bit of writing, well, watching telly, reading a book. Yeah, and here I was trying to educate you on this amazing landmark in modern television. Neither of you gave a shit.
Correct.
Excellent. I'm glad cleared that up. And that's Injustice is it for another episode of the Pilot TV podcast. We do hope you enjoyed it. Certainly enjoyed that last bit more than Terry and Boyd did. As ever, if you would like to leave us some kind words and a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts, it would be much appreciated. And if there are some people in your life that you quite like, then why not recommend the show to them as well? We're not proud. We will happily accept charity. And since you're in a charitable mood, why not follow all of us on Twitter and Instagram at James C. Dyer, at Boyd Hilton, and at Terry_White/@TerryLWhite, depending on platform. It continues to be a source of much pain that Boyd has literally 5 times as many Twitter followers as I do. And I've resigned myself to never catching up with him. But I reckon with your help, I can definitely take him on Instagram. So please follow me there. We will be back next week with a bunch more shows, up to a maximum of 6, I'm now told, all of which must be aired a full 2 meters apart and can only be watched outdoors while weeing in a hedge. Pilot out.